Hi everyone, this is a little bit of bonus footage to go with our recent podcast we recorded with Steve Strogatz. There'll be links on the screen and in the video description.
Well, we're in London, England at the Royal Society in the Council Room, and I'm here with the librarian of the Royal Society, Keith, who has very kindly brought out manuscripts from Isaac Newton and Leibniz and Isaac Barrow and the people at the beginning of calculus.
Exactly right, and this particular volume is the Commercium Apostolicum, which is one of Newton's more interesting publications.
So this, as I understand it, is documentation provided. Let's see, Newton is trying to make the case that he created calculus before Leibniz?
That's right, so they're pulling together all the relevant documents to demonstrate that Newton was the originator of calculus.
Well, let's take a look at some. I was very struck with that Isaac Barrow letter that you showed me. I would like to read that if I can not lose it. All right, let me try. So this is Isaac Barrow, who is often regarded as Newton's teacher. He certainly was a lecturer at the time that Newton was a student at Trinity College, Cambridge.
And he's a very able mathematician himself.
That's right. Absolutely. Isaac Barrow, some people feel, discovered the fundamental theorem of calculus himself. Mm. And Newton's version of it looks very Barrowian, as we would say. So this letter is Isaac Barrow writing to, who is it? Is it to John Collins?
It is, yes. So we can just see here it says Trinity College, August the 20th, 1669. And I can probably just flip the page there. It says Barrow to Collins.
Yes. So John Collins is a little bit confusing to me. I don't know how to describe him. I think of him as a hub of a correspondence network. He likes to send letters on behalf of, he's a pretty decent mathematician himself, though maybe a little more of a mathematical wannabe. He's not really remembered for his mathematics as much as for facilitating conversations between people like Barrow and Leibniz and others.
One of the things I like about these letters is that they are terribly gentlemanly conversations.
Yes, they do. So here we have Newton, who is a student, but who has essentially started to develop the technique of using infinite series to solve problems about areas under curves and tangent lines to curves and many other problems in geometry. And so I think Barrow, but of course Newton is very secretive, and so little of what he has done is known to the world. He's keeping it within the confines of the walls of Trinity College, except that Mr. Barrow has started to let some of it out. And so he's telling John Collins, and once you tell Collins, it's out. You're telling the world. So this is, I guess, Newton is ready for prime time in the mind of Isaac Barrow at this point. And so he has earlier sent something to Collins, and he now says, apparently Collins was ecstatic at this trove that had been sent to him. And so Barrow, and I quote this in the book that I've written, but it's very, very thrilling to me to see the pen of Isaac Barrow in his own hand. Here it is. "I'm glad my friend's paper giveth you so much satisfaction." I'm going to lose it right here. "His name is Mr. Newton, a fellow of our college, very young, being in the second year Master of Arts."
That's correct, yes.
"But of an extraordinary genius and proficiency in these things. You may impart the papers, if you please, to..." To Lord Brunker.
President of the Royal Society himself,
right. But so the phrase that rings to me is the "of an extraordinary genius and proficiency in these things." Yeah. Yes.
So they're really alerting the world to the fact that they have this genius in Cambridge.
Yes.
And by the early 1672, Newton is brought into the sphere of the Royal Society, and that's when he begins to talk about his papers on light and colours.
Ah.
So this is really kind of Newton getting out of it.
Thank you.
He's not super famous at this point.
No.
He's been discovered.
He's a kid.
Yeah.
He's a kid. It's 1669. So he's born in 1642. This puts him at 27 years old, but nobody knows he exists except in Trinity College.
But the 1660s, this is the period when he's doing his
Yes.
Most fabulous work.
Oh, yes.
But he's doing it in relative anonymity, apart from this tight group of friends that he has, that he might just let a little bit of this information slip out.
Mm-hmm. Right. I mean, it's 5 years already since he's begun his studies, and they often speak of his miraculous year as being 1666. Some historians would tell you it's really 2 years, 1665 and 66. But so this is now 3 years later, and Newton has done amazing work already and started to compile some of it in manuscripts that are organized. That it's unclear, is he writing them only for his own consumption to make them organized, or does he want to share them a little bit?
He shares them a little bit, but he's you would expect if you'd done this great work, you would rush it into print. That's what a modern scientist would do. And of course, this is years, and he just hasn't bothered.
And what is your take on why he wouldn't? Is he shy? Is he concerned? I mean, we later see, you mentioned about the telescope.
Yeah.
That helps to make him even more sensitive,
yes.
Right?
There are a few things going on with Newton. He's clearly wrapped up in his own thoughts and researches, and it's very internalized, mm-hmm. I think. He's not apparently terribly interested in publishing. He doesn't like conflict. He doesn't like it when people disagree with
right.
him. And one of the ways that's going to happen is if you put your ideas out into mm-hmm. the world. So, you know, and immediately, you know, when he starts to go into print in the philosophical transactions, people start to push back. No, I think that's actually good for someone.
Yes. You know,
it's good for Newton, certainly, when he starts getting into conflicts with people like Hooke.
Yes.
It makes him refine his work. But he clearly didn't like it.
No, he didn't like it. A quote of his from around that time, a little bit later, he says that he did not like being baited by little smatterers in mathematics. And I think I don't know if he's referring to Hooke as the little smatterer, possible. Hooke himself was very diminutive, I think, possibly hunchback. Or, not a big, tall person.
Newton himself wasn't that tall.
So he's not criticizing him on the basis of size.
Some scholars have suggested that, but, you know, Newton wasn't a huge six-footer either.
Okay. But the little smatterer in mathematics is to say, you know, why would I waste my time talking to people who don't even remotely understand what I'm doing?
So this is the Diana Lissy manuscript, and you can see it's sent by Mr. Barrow to Mr. Collins in a letter, July 21st, 1669. So this is the exciting pieces of paper that
yes.
we've been talking about in the previous correspondence.
Right.
And here we start to get...
Right, this is the beginning of calculus, as we would see it today. We have the written in Latin, so I will be out of my depth here, but roughly speaking, this is the analysis of equations having an infinite number of terms. So what we would today speak of as infinite power series. And so this is how Newton begins calculus, is through the use of power series, which is to us a little ironic because that usually comes at the end of a calculus course as taught today. But for him, it's the fundamental tool.
And is he looking at this as a method of solving particular real world problems?
He's not at this point. For him, the real world, as close as he gets to the real world, is to think about curves. Which are the various curves that we're seeing drawn here. So he's interested in questions about the area under a hyperbola. And today that leads us to the concept of the natural logarithm, which does have connections to many real world problems about exponential growth and decay of anything, whether in radioactivity or bacteria or anything that changes exponentially. But
this must be like seeing the Bible in God's handwriting for you.
That's right. That's exactly what it's like. The Bible, funny to say it that way, because I think of that as written, but as you say, in God's handwriting, right? This is not the human Bible. This is the Newtonian Bible. Yeah, it's unbelievable to see it. And the exactitude of the printing. I mean, of course, there are little crossouts. He is a human being. Yeah. He's not a God, but still.
Steve, how does this compare to what I would see if I went through your notebooks?
I do have nice printing, but not as nice as this. You know, he's creating worlds here in his mind.
And I think there's something else about that. Part of the reason it's a fair copy is because he's presenting it to someone else to read.
Yes.
It's not quite in the guise of being something to go into print, but still.
That's right.
He's trying to make it intelligible.
Yeah, when we see his college manuscripts, which I don't, that would not be in this volume, I suppose, but those are quite rough. compared to this. Right. This is an interesting example of his love of calculation. I mean, look how many digits he uses. He carries things out to several. I suppose we could probably find some with even more. There are some famous ones where he has 50 digits. So lots of working with infinite series here. Students would recognize these as, I mean, here's an interesting one in that it has fractional powers, x to the half, x to the 3/2. That's not just integer powers of x, but having fractional powers is a little more complicated. He was one of the first to understand properties of fractional powers, and like square roots and related things.
So, Steve, speaking of the Bible,
yes.
Keith has gone and got something else for you from downstairs.
Is that right?
Yeah. I thought we should have a look at some more Newton material.
Oh, so, please.
Let's go for it.
Oh, wait a minute. Not Principia.
Not just any Principia.
Oh, no. What? What does this mean? Which Principia? Manuscript. Uh-oh. You mean the one that they made the actual book from?
Yeah, so this is the manuscript that created the first edition.
So this is what the printers would have used?
Yes. So this is, originally would have been loose sheets, of course. So this would be what Edmund Halley saw through the press. They would give the printers sheet by sheet, and they would make the set the press from that at the time. Mm.
Oh, let's see. So definition one. Here we're laying down. I mean, if these are the Ten Commandments, except these are the three. Are they going to be three? Well, let's see. Definitions. Quantity of material. I don't actually know how the Principia begins, but it seems to be quantity of material, quantity of motion. Am I seeing that right? Yeah. So he's going to be defining momentum, I suppose, and maybe close to F equals MA, but his version of it.
So the laws of motion are here.
Ah.
So here we go.
And so, of course, this is the Euclidean framework, right? This is the ultimate in reasoning for mathematicians for thousands of years, to begin with the definitions and the axioms.
That's right. And Principia itself was a standard text for many years, of course.
Yes.
So this is quite an important book.
That's got to be Isaac Newton's thumbprint there, isn't it?
Well, this is the typesetter. So they're setting the type. They've got ink on their fingers. And of course, they're leaving these little marginal notes here.
Figure 13 goes here.
Yeah, you can. Even at this stage, they're still correcting. So you can see they're crossing stuff out.
Ah.
And they're indicating where the figures go. You will get scribbles on the reverse of the sheets as well. A bit of Newton there, I think. So this is the almost the final version, but the print version is the final.
And maybe for mathematically minded readers, we should, or listeners or viewers, we should notice that he's not using infinite series anymore.
That's right. Yes.
You know, he has the view that geometry and sort of pseudo geometry that is really calculus in disguise, but it's his geometric version of calculus, will be more convincing to his contemporaries than infinite series, which would still be newfangled and a little bit suspect. He wants us to convince the skeptics. So he's recouched. And also, he himself finds geometry more persuasive than infinite series. Oh, out.
Out. So lots of little outs here where they're taking and correcting as they go.
Uh-huh.
What does the out mean?
Take it out.
Take it out. Delete? They're rather...
Stuff we weren't supposed to know.
Yeah.
There could be new material here.
Well.
Yeah, unclear why it should be removed. And then typos, I see. So there's a cross out. That's supposed to be ASP.
I mean, Isaac Newton complained about his amanuensis because he was copying this but didn't understand it.
Yes.
It's
a lot to ask, isn't it?
It's a bit unfair on the poor guy, really, you know. But,
even to this day, it's considered a very difficult book to read for professional physicists or mathematicians.
If you'd like to see even more about Principia and Annalisi and all this sort of stuff, there'll be links on the screen and down below in the video description. Please do check it out and have a look at our Objectivity channel where we do this sort of stuff all the time.
And then, I mean, he's going to correct me when I'm wrong here. He's already slightly scowled at me. And then they were generally all right about it for a little while, but then Newton decided, no, he wanted the credit. He's integrating. It's the first time someone's integrated.
Uh-huh. Other than Leibniz.
Just.
No, not until the 1670s. Don't worry about it.